God, we worship you and thank you for all that you've done, God. We thank you that you have brought us to yourself by your Son, Jesus Christ, his blood shed on the tree, God. And we thank you for this day that you have given us, God. Better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere. Better is one day with your body in the presence of Christ to worship you and see you, God, than 1,000 other days elsewhere, Lord. We thank you for your body that you went to the cross, Lord Jesus, and took our sin, took the wrath that we deserve, rose victorious 3 days later, and called us to yourself, God, that you've given us everything in Christ, that you are the answer for all things, the person of Jesus Christ, God. We come to worship you and see you more, God. And we thank you, Lord, that even though there's many trials that we go through and suffering in this life and loss, and so because of sin, Lord, that you guide us through them and teach us to lean on you and trust in you, God, to suffer with you, that we may be glorified with you, God. We pray for those who can't be here today that you heal them and strengthen them, God. And we thank you that we are one in you, that we join the heavenly host and in worshiping you here today, God. I pray for Pastor Chris as he comes, that you would fill him and that you would teach us, Lord, by your Spirit, lead us into all truth, God, that we would behold your glory and be changed by seeing you more, God, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. If you would stand with me, the scripture reading today is Philippians 4, 1 through 9. Hear the word of the living God. Therefore, my brothers, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm thus in the Lord, my beloved. I entreat Euodia and I entreat Syntyche to agree in the Lord. Yes, I ask you also, true companion, help these women who have labored side by side with me in the gospel together with Clement and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. Amen.
It is, I'll say, unfortunately, good to be with you today. Unfortunately, because, as you probably know, both Nick and Eric and their families are battling with COVID and the outfall of that. And on Thursday, Eric reached out and just asked if I could fill in. And I said, of course, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to be able to share the word with you. I'm sure, though, you would enjoy having your shepherds here caring for you, and I trust I can do a job that will honor them and encourage you. It is good to see you this morning. If you take your Bibles and turn to that Philippians passage, we're going to look at just one verse out of it, if we could. I hadn't read the whole passage. I want to focus our attention on just one verse, if I could. Verse 8 is where I'd like to direct our attention this morning. You know, social scientists, pundits, scholars are beginning to assess the 21st century, and one of the seems to be a common thread that they're seeing is in the 21st century, especially in the West, a loss of critical thinking skills. Seems like as a people, this is a skill that we're losing. We're not able to engage with it. Critical thinking simply is this ability to analyze information objectively and make a reasoned judgment between useful and less useful information. And it seems like social scientists now are coming to the conclusion that this is an area that we really are starting to wrestle with and trying to come to terms with. What will we do? How will we address issues like this in the future? I find it remarkable that when you look into the New Testament especially, the Bible in general, but the New Testament specifically, how much emphasis the New Testament puts on our minds. That's pretty remarkable. We'll look at a few verses that we'll talk about it. This passage specifically, as we look at verse 8 in this passage, we see that what Paul is trying to do, very simply, is just talk to us about a godly thought life. He wants to give us the as I've entitled this message, the art of thinking. He wants us to be able to look at life and begin to process it in a way that is truly going to be beneficial to us. And that's what I'd like to do this morning, if I could, is just take some time and talk about that, of how we can develop a godly thought life out of this verse that we see here. If we could, I'd like to begin with just the context of the mind as we look at this verse. Let's think about the city of Philippi for a moment. Let's think about their context before we think about ours. As you think about the city of Philippi, right, we know, we have information about it. We can go into the book of Acts. We can find its beginning. It started in like about AD 49. It was in Paul's second missionary journey. You remember probably that, if you're familiar with the story, that Paul was trying to go into southern Turkey to advance the gospel, and that's where he got that, what's referred to as the Macedonian call, the vision of the one who was calling over from Macedonia, come and preach the gospel to us. And as Paul sensed the Lord closing the door in southern Turkey, he realized the Lord was opening a door on the southern European continent. And so he went off and he took off to that region, and he went into Philippi and he preached the gospel, if you remember. You also probably remember that when Paul preached the gospel there, he encountered a lot of conflict. It was a very interesting experience, the beginning of that church. Paul's tendency was to go to a synagogue. That's how he'd always go into a town. That was the way in which he approached the advancement of the gospel. He'd go to the religious people, the Jews first. He'd go into the synagogue, and because of the way the synagogue was structured, they'd always invite teachers who could come in to teach. They would allow them to have a word, as it were. Since Paul was a trained teacher, a Pharisee in his background, he would come into these settings and he would be given the avenue, the opportunity to teach from the Old Testament. Paul would take that opportunity to use the Old Testament to present Jesus. You know, as that would unfold and take place, some would respond and some would reject. In Philippi, they reject pretty strongly, to the extent that they brought him before the magistrate and they put him in jail. Now, you probably remember from the book of Acts that when Paul went into Philippi, he didn't go to a synagogue. That was very strategic. That was the way he normally did it. But he didn't go to a synagogue. He went down by the river. It says in the Sabbath out of the book of Acts, it says he went down to the river and he found some women there praying. Now, the reason why Paul went to the river was because in the town of Philippi, he could not find a synagogue. He could not find a synagogue because, based on tradition, it would take 10 men to form a synagogue. So in the city of Philippi, there were not 10 Jewish men that they could gather together to form a synagogue. So what did they do instead? They would go down by the river. Now again, this comes from their history. Can you think of another time in Jewish history when they would be at a river wanting and thinking about the land of Israel? Again, the book of Ezekiel tells you when they were in the Babylonian captivity, they were by the river when Ezekiel received his many visions, when the children of Israel would gather and long for their homeland. It would be by that river. So the tradition started that if they could not form a synagogue, which is out of the Babylonian captivity came the history of the synagogue, if they could not have a synagogue, they would go by the river and they would begin to interact and engage with God. That's where Paul found these people. You probably remember the origin of that church. The origin of that church was a woman, seller of purple, Lydia, and her household. You also know that part of that church was a young girl who was filled with the Spirit, it says, and she was proclaiming that Paul was a servant of the Most High God. You know Paul cast the demon spirit out of that young girl. We also know that Paul and Silas ended up in jail. And through this supernatural work of God, where this earthquake took place and the jail cells opened and Paul could have left, they remained. The jailer thought he was going to have to give up his life, which, because he lost his patrons, that he would have to give up his life, that Paul told him not to. And then he and his household came to the faith. So think about the background of this church. When Paul talks to these believers, there's this woman who is the seller of purple. There is this young slave girl. And there was this Philippian jailer. And who knows who else then came to the faith. Kind of an interesting group of people that had come together. We know something else about the church of Philippi. It was a poor church. 2 Corinthians chapter 8 talks about this church had no wealth. It was poverty stricken. So that was another thing that we know about it. Think about just the passage you read, that you heard read for you this morning. Think about what was going on in the church itself. So that's kind of like the origins of the church. Now think about what was going on in the church. Let's go backwards if we could. Verse 6, they were worried about something. We don't know what. It just says, be anxious for nothing. Don't worry, but pray. What were they worried about? Well, if you were poor, living in an outpost of Rome, in a Roman colony, you found your church in the origin, finding its origin in conflict. I mean, there's probably a lot you could be worried about. So he tells them, don't worry. They were anxious. They were anxious about something. He says, let your reasonableness be known, verse 5, to all men. That word reasonableness is a really interesting word. It's probably one of the hardest words to translate in the New Testament. We really don't have an equivalent of an English term that conveys the thought of this word. You saw the ESV translates it reasonableness. I think that was NASB up on the screen. It translated it gentleness. The King James will translate it meekness. The idea of this word is that in the face of provocation and evil, you are calm. It's a really interesting word. Meekness probably is, I think that old English term is probably the best word. It has the idea of power under control. Every time I think about it, what I think of is, because I just love driving fast, I think of a car that has a really powerful engine. I think of a Dodge product that's got this massive Hemi engine in it, and you can go like really super fast. Like I want to go to Montana just to drive the highway. Because there they like restrict, there's no restriction of the speed limit. Like you can drive as fast as you want. Like that's where I want to go. I want to go to the Autobahn. I want to drive as fast as I can. I want to take this power under control and unleash it. That's this word meekness. So when he says, let your reasonableness be known to all men, the Lord is at hand. I think what he's saying is in your world, in Philippi, in your world, there's a lot of conflict, turbulence regarding the faith. And he says, don't respond in like kind, right? We don't respond evil for evil. What do we respond evil with? Good. So Paul, we respond evil with good. The Lord is at hand. You read the creed. The creed said he will come and he will judge the living and the dead. Paul says in Romans chapter 12, vengeance is mine. He goes, you don't repay. You, as far as you're able, you live at peace with all men. I will repay. Vengeance is mine. We don't step into his place. And so he says reasonableness. So that tells me that there's some turbulence in their world. Then back it up a little further. Interpersonal relationships, verses 2 and 3. These two ladies are having some kind of problem. We don't know what, but they're having some kind of problem. There's some kind of issue going on here. Don't know what the issue is. We just know that they were faithful fellow laborers with Paul. They were engaged in ministry, and there was something between them. And Paul is appealing to somebody else to help them overcome their differences so that the gospel wouldn't be hindered and they could labor together. In other words, there was conflict without, division within. And then he says, based upon chapter 3 and possibly the false teaching that might have been coming through Judaism at them, he tells them to stand firm. That verb he uses there to stand firm is the statement that Paul makes when there's this push of false teaching on believers. And he says, when believers are pushed with false teaching, we are to stand firm. We are to stand against it, but we are not to move off the rock upon which we have built our lives. Now we come to our verse. That's the context in Philippi for our verse. See, suddenly now when he says, I want you to think on these things, Man, that is very different, isn't it? Like, think on these things. There's a lot going on in Philippi. Think about America right now, 2020. Right? A lot going on, isn't there? I mean, man, there's a lot going on right now that we have in our country. Right now. The pandemic. I'm here because of the pandemic. I mean, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the pandemic. Pastor Eric would be here. Pastor Nick might be here. I mean, somebody else would be here. Somebody of your fellowship. Like, there's nothing wrong with that. I don't mind it. But the pandemic has created a lot of turbulence. We're coming into Thanksgiving. Families are apart. Will they get together? How will we deal with it? A lot of noise around the pandemic. What's true? What's not true? I mean, if you are a conspiracy theorist, man, you are having a party, aren't you? Because, I mean, you look online, there's every conspiracy out there about what's going on with this thing. There's a lot of turbulence going on. A lot to agitate our minds, get us moving. Think about the election. I was looking forward to November 3rd because I thought it would be over. Like, whoever wins, okay, it's life, right? That's just the way it goes. It's okay. Like, somebody's going to win. And I thought it'd be done. Man, I've got a sister living in Georgia. I sent her a text and I said, she said to me, in this text, she said, how you doing? I said, I'm doing great. I said, I can't imagine your life. You got 8 more weeks of campaigning. Man, I'm like, I can't. Like, I was ready to have this thing done. Is it gonna be done? I don't know. It is just crazy. Like, who is the president? Well, we got one now. Do we have another one? Will we have another one? I don't know. I mean, is Michigan for Trump? Is he for Biden? I don't know. Is it true? Is it been an election that has been stolen? Or is this a legitimate election? I don't know. A lot to get your mind agitated with. Religious liberty. In my 30-odd years in the life of the church, as I've been a shepherd, I have never heard more discussion about religious liberty than I'm hearing today. Man, it's just all over the place, religious liberty. Will we have our religious liberties? Will we be able to continue to experience what we've experienced in our nation, being free to worship the way we want to? Like, there's a genuine discussion going on in so many circles about religious liberties. The economy, man, we are, because of the pandemic and the election, is all this discussion about the economy. Culture, we have I thought the culture wars were maybe kind of dying down. Man, they are just being stoked with fire right now. Is there a lot to capture your mind? Yes, there is, dear friend. That's why what Paul says here about the art of thinking is really critical for us as believers. If there was ever a time the church needed to think clearly about issues, it's today. We need to be really wise in the way we approach life, because the mission of the church has not changed, dear friends. In light of all the circumstances and situations that we're finding ourselves in, the mission of the church has remained. It's the advancement of the gospel. He said he will build his church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. He said he will accomplish his purpose as we commit ourselves to doing his will regardless of our circumstances. And that is why what Paul says here is so powerful to us about, finally, my brothers, he says, think on these things. That's what he says. Right? He just says, I'll get it there. It'll come. There it is. Finally, brothers, look at the verse, right? I've taken out the description, and I've just given you the kind of the meat of the verse, like the force of it. Finally, brothers, think about these things. And it's that verb to think. That's what he wants us to do. That's the amazing thing about what God has done through our salvation in Christ Jesus. Think with me, if you would, just for a moment, about the transformation of the mind. Prior to salvation, let's think about how we saw and understood life. This is the way the Bible describes kind of the way we think, right? The Bible will talk about our minds being depraved. Our minds being depraved. The Bible will talk about our minds being hostile. The Bible will talk about our minds being darkened. The Bible will talk about our minds being blinded. Listen to these verses if you could. Romans chapter 1, verse 28. And since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a debased mind, a depraved mind, to do what not ought to be. 1 Timothy 6, 5, talking about false teachers. And constant friction among them, and constant friction among people who are depraved in mind and deprived of the truth, imagining that godliness is a means of gain. 2 Timothy 3:18, Paul talks about these two gentlemen that opposed Moses, and he says, "So these men also opposed the truth, men corrupted in mind and disqualified regarding the faith." The mind prior to salvation, the Bible talks about, is depraved. One of the ideas of depravity is that it's twisted. That's the idea that it's God. Like, isn't it amazing how we are able to moralize in reverse? Just the exact opposite of the way God would have us. That's depravity. That's what happens. That's our mind prior to the light of the gospel. The Bible says our minds are hostile to God. Romans chapter 8, verses 6 through 8. Listen to these verses. "For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the spirit is life and peace." Here's the verse. "For the mind set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to the law of God, to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God." In other words, we're hostile in our mind prior to salvation. We won't bow to the authority of God. We resist that authority. Our minds want to throw that authority off. Our minds are darkened. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 17 through 19. "Now this I say and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardness of their heart. They have become callous and have given themselves over to sensuality, greedy to practice every kind of impurity." Listen to these words as Paul talks about our minds being blinded. Think of this in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 3 through 6. He says this, "And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we proclaim is not ourselves, but Christ, Jesus Christ is Lord, with ourselves as servants for Jesus' sake. For God said, 'Let light shine out of darkness.' He shone into our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ." Isn't that amazing? That's what salvation has brought us. Salvation has brought us a transformation of our minds. We have the opportunity through the new birth to begin to think rightly. We couldn't think rightly before. Our critical thinking was skewed. We couldn't make the proper judgments in life. Because of that, now through Jesus Christ and our salvation, we can think rightly. So Paul comes to these words to the church at Philippi at the end of the letter. The last thing he wants to say to them is, "Now I want to get in between your ears. I want to get into your head. I want you to be aware. Finally, brothers, it's the last thing I'm going to say to you. I want you to now think about these things. I want you now to contemplate these things. I want you now to engage your mind on these things. I want you to give the time that is necessary to begin to unpack all that God is and what he has accomplished." Think about the transformation of the mind proceeding from salvation. Just a few verses. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 22 through 24. He says, "To put off the old self, which belongs to the former manner of life and is corrupted through the deceitful desires." And here's the statement. This is the one Paul likes to use quite often. "And to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness." And it's that phrase, to be renewed in the spirits of your mind. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 3 says a similar thing. "I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world." Don't be molded by what we have here, he says. "But be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 and 2, he says this: if then you have been raised up with Christ, keep seeking the things above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, he said, not on things that are on the earth. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 1, this is what he says: this is now the second letter I am writing to you, beloved. In both of them, I am stirring up your sincere mind by way of reminder. Again, look at Philippians 4. Look at the structure of the verse. The verb in the verse is to think. The verbs give us the action. The verbs give us the structure of language, right? We need verbs. Without verbs, we'd really struggle in communicating. So the verbs in the New Testament are powerful. They're the way in which they get us to move to action. And so the verb here is, he says, I want you to think. This verb to think is to think about something in detail, not just in a cursory way. It's interesting in today's model of education that what some are coming to is the conclusion that all we need to do is be hunters of information, gatherers of information, rather than thinking about information. You've had it happen. Someone says something, and you've got Google. And you can just look up on Google what it might be. Like, I don't need to know it. I got Google, and Google can tell me about it. And I can just look and gather a piece of information real fast. I appreciate the way you can do that today. I think that's great that that's the case. You can grab that. But one of the unintended consequences of that is that we lost this ability, we're losing, I should say, this ability to be able to stop and ponder and think in detail about something. It's affected teaching. Man, you go too long in teaching, watch people get really squirrely. They start to get a little nervous. I can't stay focused. Like, what's going on between your head? You think about this. We think this is the space that nobody knows about what's going on here. Think about this gathering. How many times have you gathered in structures like this and what's going on here has nothing to do with what's going on here? Like, if we can actually see a pop-up go over your head, what would you be actually thinking? Because no one can see it. Like, no one knows what you're thinking. You can sit there and look very, like, I could look at you as a speaker. I could look at the audience and go, man, they were glued. Like, they were wired in. They were there. And then someone asks, like, maybe 20 minutes later, somebody asks a question about what was said. And it's like, I didn't hear that. What did he say? Oh, that's right. I was thinking about, I got to work on my car this afternoon. And man, I was just consumed because it was just like, yeah, I got to fix this thing. And my mind just wandered away. It's easy to happen, isn't it? It's simple to let what happens here just kind of move away. It's difficult to remain focused and locked in to what you're trying to think. Paul wanted to address their thinking. And so he said, I want you to think about this. I want you to take some time to think about this. And so he uses these words in this. He uses these words, whatever and any. Notice the verse. He uses these two pronouns. Look at it. Verse 8. He says, in Philippians 4:8, he says this. He says, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable. So he uses these six, he's got six virtues here, but the constant in the six virtues is this pronoun, whatever. This pronoun removes any restriction. That's what it does. There's no restriction. He doesn't have one thing in mind regarding what he's saying about the virtue. There's a lot we can say about it. He wants to lift the restrictions off it and let it run, let it go. So he's not trying to get us to think about one specific thing. He wants to fill our minds with these things, a lot of this. Like, spend your time here thinking about these things. Notice in the verse, you see it, he then changes the pronoun from what if to any or anything. He then says, if there's anything excellent, verse 8, if there's anything worthy of praise, then he comes with the force of the statement, the command that he gives in the present tense. In other words, this is something we are to continually do. This is his instruction. Here, think about these things. The change in pronouns shows us that this list isn't restrictive. It's not just these virtues. There's a whole lot of virtues you can think about. Are there things that are excellent? Think about it. What would be an excellent virtue or a virtue worthy of praise that he doesn't list here? Maybe courage. You think they might need that? If their reasonableness needs to be known to all men, do you think they need courage to stand for the cause of Christ in a world that's fallen and broken and wanting to abuse them? Maybe they need courage, bravery. That's a good thing to think about. How about generosity? How about commitment? Moderation? Kindness? There's a few more for you. In other words, what Paul was saying was he wasn't trying to give a restricted, defined sense that these are the only ones you should think about. There's a lot to think about when it comes to our faith. In other words, you can fill up a lot of your time thinking about these things. Think about your day. Think about the time in your day and how much you spend thinking about yourself, your circumstances, your life. Think about how much of your time is consumed with that. I think what Paul is trying to say is he's not trying to deny what they may be going through. He's trying to give them pathways out of where they are so they're not overwhelmed by those things. They can actually live in the midst of those things and live in such a way that they genuinely display what is different about them. How are we as believers different living in a pandemic? I was just talking about this. We've been talking about this extensively. I was just talking about somebody in our church, in between our morning service. We have a little time of fellowship that we just get together and have coffee. And we were talking about just people seem to be, you know, extremely frightened. Like they're, you look in outside of the church, people are really frightened about this. And I said to this person, he's a medical person, and I said, yeah, you know, it makes sense to me. If we live in a society that has tried to step away from death, like we don't want to look at death, we don't want to see death, we want to think that we could live forever, that medical science is the means to live forever, that they will always provide us the answer to everything that affects us, and suddenly there is this virus that is taking life. Like, it's taking life, and a remarkable number of lives, 250,000 people have perished. That's a lot of people. Worldwide, it's in the millions. That's a lot of people. I get why in the world people are afraid. Because if I didn't have Jesus, you know, I don't know what happens after death. So I get why they're afraid. The thing I'm really perplexed by, why are believers equally so afraid? Like, we are a people that we exalt the one who has conquered the grave. You're going to celebrate. We're going to celebrate the table here in just a moment. And as we celebrate the table, the main point of the table is we proclaim what? His death until he comes. In other words, we're acknowledging through his death came life, and that eternal. And so how could it be that we as a people are gripped by such fear if that is the foundation of our life? And we were talking about that. And we were commenting on how easy it is for believers to get caught up into that. You see why Paul's words are so powerful to us today? As powerful as they were to the church at Philippi in that ancient time. Man, we got to think about these things. Our minds need to dwell there. I love that verb, that this word to think, we could translate it the word to dwell, to live there. I like that. I like that image. Like, you have to live there. That's what you have to do. So what I'd like to do for the rest of our, just briefly, we're not going to go through all of these. We could. It would be a great study, and hopefully you will do it. I just want to take the first one, whatever is true, and kind of show you how you can unpack that, how you can unpack that to let your mind dwell there, to really enjoy what that says, to let your mind, what is true. Beautiful word. The word true, truth, in the New Testament, conveys the idea of what's real. Philosophically, in the Western world, we see truth abstractly, right? What is truth? We take it as a philosophical question. Like, we can't really know it. In the ancient world, that wasn't the case. Interestingly, the word true that is translated in the Septuagint, which is a translation of the Hebrew term that it translates is the term to be firm. In other words, something concrete. Something's firm that's concrete. The word truth has the idea, in the ancient world, the word truth had the idea of reality. It's what's real. So the idea of we being in the truth is about what's real. What's real to us? That's what I love about this. If there's anything true, let's think about that. What's real, right? This is what it says, pertaining to what is real, not imaginary. Right? This isn't imaginary. It's what's real. So we start with, first off, the triune God. He's real, right? Think about how the Bible describes him. I'm just going to give you a few verses here. He says, and we know in 1 John chapter 5, verse 20, and we know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding so that we may know him. And then look at how he defines him. Who is true? Who is real? And we are in him who is true. Notice he repeated it again. Like, in other words, I don't want you to miss the fact that he's real. Why? Because there were some saying in John's context that it wasn't real, that he didn't come with a physical body. He only came as a spirit. There was no physical body there. Similar to our world, that kind of says, look at our world. Does our world acknowledge any spiritual aspect, the supernatural aspect? No, we deny it. We believe we're here as a result of just atoms and molecules coming together and existing. And out of chaos came order. So what's true? What's real? That's real. And what you believe, this God, this triune God, he's not real. But what does the word say? The word tells us he is real. 1 Thessalonians 1:9. For they themselves report concerning us the kind of reception we had among you and how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. John 17, verse 3. And this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you've sent. It's amazing, isn't it? Like, you look at what the scriptures say. This is just what the scriptures say. God is true. The triune God is true. And the word tells us that. And so you say, well, not only does the word tell us that, but listen to Psalm 19, verse 1. I love this. He says, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. Isn't that beautiful? Like, we look at creation, and it reminds us of God. So let me, again, how your mind can go there, how easy it is for our minds to go there. Last week, we had a windstorm, correct? Some of you probably left here last week, and you saw in our driveway, we had some trees down. Right? So when I came in on Monday morning, because I couldn't go to my favorite coffee shop because I couldn't go, so I came here, I saw a bigger tree had kind of fallen over, kind of crashed into the road, and it was dead. So I like doing this kind of stuff. So I later on in the afternoon, I went home, got my chainsaw, came back, cut it up. And as I was cutting it up, man, my mind was just reeling. Like, life is an illustration to a preacher. Like, it just is. And I was like, man, this is just an amazing thing. Like, God is so amazing. Like, here's this wind, this massive storm. And I didn't know that tree was rotted. I had no idea it was rotted. And the wind just knocked it down. And I thought, Lord, isn't that like us? Like, we're just rotted. Like, it doesn't take much to take us down. This is the truth. This is real. This is who we are. And this is what God has done. God takes what is useless and makes it useful. And so my mind was out there as we were just cutting up a tree, and my mind is dwelling on the truthfulness of God. God is true. Now, did I know I was going to preach this message on Monday? No, had no idea. It's just where my mind goes as I'm going through life. Not that I wasn't thinking about a chainsaw on my hands and cutting branches off. Like, I'm doing that, and I'm focused on thinking about that, because I don't want a chainsaw to swing down and catch my leg and open up my leg. So I'm like not denying that I'm holding a chainsaw and it's dangerous. But in the midst of life, as I'm going through life, I'm thinking about, God, it's true. It's real. There's corruption in the world. Man is broken and fallen. And only through redemption do we find life. It was through the brokenness of the cross that Jesus brought us life, because Jesus was willing to get on that tree and provide us salvation. See how it works? You think about the Word of God. That's just the triune God. Think about the Word of God. Think about these Bible verses. Sanctify them in truth. Thy word is truth, John 17:17. Sanctify them in truth. Sanctify them in what's real. Set them apart in what's real, what's actual. Your word is actual, it's real. Listen to this one, Psalm 22:5. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation, for I will wait all the day long. Lead me in your truth. Lead me in what's real and teach me. Psalm 119:160. The sum of your word is truth, and every one of your righteous rules endures forever. Have you ever wondered why the enemy has been so effective in the Western church and the American church specifically, to have believers so busy that they consistently say, and this is what I've heard for years now from believers, I don't have time to be in the Word. If you want to know what's true, you better be in this Word. You better spend time in the Word, reading, reminding yourself what is true. Not leaving it to your own resources to think, oh, well, I think that's true, to actually read it's true. To spend time opening the Word and reading and feasting on the Word of God. Allowing the Word of God to have its effectual work upon your life, because it's telling you truth. And if there's anything we need more than ever today, we need to know what's real. And the Word of God gives it to us, what's real. It allows us a framework, a perspective on life, to know how we should live in light of the circumstances that we find ourselves in. Let's look at the last one just very quickly, the church of God, right? Listen to what it says in 1 Timothy 3:15. He says this, if I'm delayed, he says, you may know how you ought to behave in the household of God, which is the church of the living God, a pillar and buttress of the truth. Oh, that's an amazing statement by Paul, who is saying this in light of the great temple that was there in Ephesus of Diana, which was the goddess of life. And what made this temple remarkable was the colonnade around this temple. It was one of the seven wonders of the world. Everyone came to marvel at it. And so Paul was taking that image of that false god, and he was bringing it to the true God and saying that we, his people, are built upon that foundation of the truth. Even though the world is telling us that we are stupid enough, foolish enough, dumb enough to believe, according to them, a lie. No, I love this one. Takes it out of the abstract and brings it right home to us. That's what we'll close on. Little children, isn't that a great phrase? Isn't it beautiful to be considered a little child? Man, you know, I know we're all adults, we're aged, you know, we're up there in years. We don't want to consider ourselves little kids. You know why he uses that term, little children? You know why he focuses that attention that way to call them? He wasn't making a derogatory comment about them. He wasn't referring to their inability to think. You know what he was talking about? You know what he was trying to say in that statement? Isn't that sometimes the challenge? Like, what are you trying to say, little children? Why would he call the church little children. Because children have this remarkable knack to trust. I mean, children just trust. I remember my son when he was young. He would be sitting at the dinner room at the dinner table, and he was my youngest son. And I would go to him and I'd say, "Tim, I'm going to throw you in the trash." And he would look at me and like get this terrified look on his face, and he'd say, "What?" And I said, "I'm going to throw you in the trash." And I would go over to him and start to grab him, and he would just get fright. He would be filled with fright because he actually thought I would throw him in the trash. Why? Because children think concretely. So when you say something to them, they believe it. They believe what you're saying. I think that's why John used this term, little children. He was acknowledging they were believing what he was saying. You have a testimony of faith. You have a testimony of trust. Little children, he says, let us not love in word or talk, but in deed and in truth. I just took a few moments to unpack for you one of those virtues. How much time could you spend? Think about it. There's 168 hours in a week. How many hours of the week do you spend dwelling on you? As opposed to releasing your mind and being able to dwell upon him. That's what Paul was getting at. To a church that was struggling under the weight of living in this world, the challenges that they were facing as they were going through life. As he left them, he wanted to get into their heads. He wanted to get into their minds. He wanted to affect the way they were processing life. And so he reminded them to let their minds dwell in a certain place, to hold their attention in that place, in the midst of all the noise of the world going on around them. Get your mind in a good place and contemplate these things. Think about these things. Mull them over. Not just simply quote a passage, but actually take time to think about them, the ramifications, the implications, the effect of them. I mean, isn't it a great week to do that? We're going to celebrate Thanksgiving on Thursday. Some are looking at it and saying, what a horrible year this has been. What's there to celebrate? We can't be together. This pandemic continues to ravage us. We're under these economic, in this economic times when things are really tough for people. Man, there's so much to be thankful for, isn't there? There's so much that we can stop and contemplate. I hope this Thanksgiving you can stop and dial down the noise in your life. And spend some time just reflecting upon the goodness and the graciousness of God in your life. Giving to you all that he has given you. Allowing you to have all that you possess. So that you can enjoy him. Spend some time with the space that you have in your mind. To not focus the attention of your life on you. But focus it on him. If you're not sure how to do that, again, it's pretty simple. Just look at those words. Just take those words, put them in a concordance of the scriptures, and just bring up a bunch of passages that can just allow you to think about who he is, how this would reflect out, how this would play out in your life. Just take some time to do that. I mean, take some time to fellowship around that with each other, to talk about maybe what you have seen or what you have learned of God's truth or God's purity or God's goodness. Or God's loveliness. Or the other virtues that could be meaningful in your life. Let your mind dwell there. And if it does, you will cultivate the art of thinking. And if you cultivate that art of thinking, you will be a honed tool to be used by the Lord in a world that desperately needs to know him. Father, again, we just thank you for your goodness. We're grateful for just a few moments we have to gather and look at this section of scripture to see how it affects the way in which we actually process life. And so, Lord, help us to be a people that can think rightly. Help us to value what you say to this church at Philippi is you wanted them to contemplate and think and dwell in these areas. Allow their minds to be captivated by them, captured, so that truly would be a protection against the inroads the world would want to make upon our minds. the disruption that they wish to bring to our faith. Lord, may we be able to spurn that by cultivating that art of thinking, allowing our thoughts to be godly in your sight. We ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hello, and thank you for watching this sermon. I hope it benefited you in many ways. I'm Jordan Gulledge, and I'd like to tell you a little bit more about One Life Church. You can visit us at hisonelife.com. You can also visit the Facebook page and the Instagram account. You can even download our app for Apple and Android. I highly recommend it. Until next time, take care and God bless.